Hachette Children's Group presents When Secrets Set Sail by Sita Brahmachari. Read for you by Tania Rodrigues. For my mum and dad, Nurse Frida Brahmachari and the late Dr. Brahmachari, and all the millions of people from around the world who have given their lives to working in the National Health Service and social care, your and your ancestors' lives matter deeply. Perhaps it's true that things can change in a day, that a few dozen hours can affect the outcome of whole lifetimes, and that when they do, those few dozen hours, like the salvaged remains of a burned house, the charred clock, the singed photograph, the scorched furniture, must be resurrected from the ruins and examined, preserved, accounted for. Little events, ordinary things, smashed and reconstituted, imbued with new meaning. Suddenly, they become the bleached bones of a story. From The God of Small Things by Arundhati Roy. Newspaper Baby.
I'm not sleeping in no dead person's bed. Can't I take mine with me?
As soon as the words were out of her mouth, Imtiaz clocked Deliza's deeply furrowed scowl. This was exactly the sort of double negative attitude that Deliz was on a mission to coach Imtiaz out of. The closer the day came for Imtiaz's adoption, the more Deliz got on her case and the angrier Imtiaz blew. She would never understand why Deliz couldn't stop being a social worker to everyone else in the children's home and just look after her. What else will Deliz have to do when she retires?
There's still time to change your mind, Imtiaz pleaded. You said no one's forcing you to leave the country anymore, so stay. And you and Merv can foster me. You're always saying how I should accept an apology. Well, the government have said sorry about how they treated you, haven't they?
Immy.
Deliz shook her head, exasperated.
Remember, you promised not to keep on with this. We've made our decision.
Deliz placed a comforting arm around Imtiaz's shoulder.
Don't worry about the bed. I'm sure you'll be getting a new one. Just wait and see your beautiful new ship of a room.
Deliz winked at Imtiaz.
And don't look at me like that. All will be revealed, you'll see. That top deck's beyond your wildest dreams, I promise.
Doubt it,
Imtiaz mumbled, pulling away from Deliz.
I'm telling you, Imi, this is meant to be. I can't tell you how happy it makes me that I've been able to settle this adoption. When I think about how it's all fallen into place, it does feel like a little miracle. Me meeting Merv and discovering his family wanted to adopt, and them sharing the same surname as you, like it was God's will. Don't go bringing God into it.
You said you called me that because you had a school friend with that surname. Just so happy it's all been so convenient. At least you get to wash your hands of me now before you go sailing off into your Caribbean sunset.
Deliz took hold of Imtiaz's flailing hands before she could whip herself up into more of a state.
That's enough, Imi.
Imtiaz caught the fire in Deliz's eyes and knew not to push any further. It was no use anyway. Last year, when Deliz was arrested, had changed everything.
Detained for, as far as Imtiaz could understand, nothing, except for Deliz's parents not travelling with documents for her as a baby on the ship called Windrush, like half a century ago. It still didn't make any sense. But at least they had released Deliz quickly and given her the money that was called reparation, because it was supposed to repair the damage done for arresting her.
When she'd heard about this, Imtiaz had got her hopes up and she'd sprung at Deliz and hugged her.
So you don't have to go then?
Great sobs had heaved out of Deliz as they'd held each other. It was the first time Imtiaz had ever seen Deliz cry like that, so Imtiaz had cried too, and wished she could look after Deliz for the rest of her life, like Deliz had looked after her.
No money could ever repair how I feel. This country doesn't feel like home anymore,
Deliz had whispered when she'd finally calmed down. Imtiaz knew in her heart there was no point arguing with Deliz. She supposed there was one advantage in Deliz hooking up with Merv. She'd learnt more about the Joseph family than anyone being adopted would normally know. Not that all the getting-to-know-you meetings had got any less awkward over time. Mostly, Usha had just sat quietly with her mum and dad, Tanvi and Lem, banged on about how much Usha had always wanted a sister. Just a shame Usha herself couldn't even be bothered to look her straight in the eye, let alone attempt a smile.
Every time you meet, it'll get a bit easier between you,
Deliz constantly reassured Imtiaz. But it didn't. Maybe they would have had more of a chance to talk if they'd had somewhere chill to go, instead of having to compete with all the comings and goings on the ground floor of the house, the bit they called the hearth.
What even is a hearth, anyway?
Asked Imtiaz. Deliz's face softened.
A kind of fireplace to gather around and find a bit of warmth at. As you know, it's refugee people, mostly. Good name for it, don't you think?
Imtiaz shrugged.
I didn't see no fire in there.
I didn't see any fire, Deliz corrected.
That's because there isn't one, Imtiaz grinned.
And despite Deliz's nitpicking at the repeated double negative, her face broke into sunshine.
Why couldn't I be in a family where I'm the only one who needs help?
Imtiaz complained.
That's not like any kind of family I've ever heard of. They're a busy, caring crew, the Josephs, always helping people. I think you'll soon settle.
As long as I'm not just another of their charity cases. Maybe that's why Usha's so weird. She probably just wants her house to herself, and now she's got me to deal with.
She's shy and sad about her gran dying, that's all. Give Usha a chance. She's had a lot to deal with too.
All I'm saying is they'd better clear out all her granny's stuff.
Deliz placed a finger over her own mouth, her signal for Imtiaz to choose her words more carefully.
Anyhow, weren't you supposed to be at their ashes sailing ceremony thing?
Deliz shook her head.
I was invited, but I said my goodbyes at the funeral, and I've still got so much to organise before we go.
I'm handing over to the new manager later. You're all sorted, though.
Deliz scanned the bare, posterless walls of Imtiaz's room, settling on the suitcase and crate of belongings stacked and waiting to be picked up.
I haven't got that much, Imtiaz shrugged. Everything she owned could more or less be fitted into a case and a crate. Not exactly impressive for 11 years of growing up here.
I'd better get on.
Deliz stood stiffly and reached up to the shelf above the bed. Taking down a card, she waved it at Imtiaz, her face growing stern.
Immy, you told me you'd sent this.
Imtiaz shrugged.
I was waiting for Usha to invite me to the funeral, or at least this ashes-spreading ceremony. In any case, I couldn't work out what to say. Never even met Usha's gran. Anyway, isn't it too late to send now?
Deliz thrust the card into Imtiaz's hand.
Just write something nice. Like what? Tell her you're sorry for her loss and that you're looking forward to seeing her soon.
Imtiaz puffed her cheeks and released a pent-up gush of air.
You want to try out that Lido, then write the card. We can post it on the way back, and they'll get it after the ceremony.
With a surly scowl, Imtiaz took the envelope from Deliz and pulled out the revolting card. One of the reasons why she hadn't been able to send it was just how gross it was, with its shiny lily on the cover, and the no-sense message inside.
It already says sorry for your loss. What else do you want me to say?
The staff-only phone in the office rang. Deliz wagged her finger at Imtiaz on the way out of the room.
I mean it, Immy. No condolence card, no swim, she cautioned, hurrying out along the corridor to the office.
I need that swim, thought Imtiaz.
One thing she was looking forward to was seeing the Lido at the end of Usha's road, where Tanvi, Usha's mum, said she could swim all year round if she was brave enough. Sighing at the card, she thought, not in a million years would I ever choose this for anyone I care about. But who would I care about enough to send one of these to? She came to the conclusion that the only person she would ever be truly sorry about dying or going away was Deliz. Sorry for your loss.
Ugh. What's that message even supposed to mean if you don't know the person you're writing to or the person who's died?
Imtiaz's pen hovered over the card.
It feels fake.
She pictured the impossible-to-read face of Usha. At least in looks, they could just about pass as siblings. Same-ish height, similar rich brown skin tone, dark eyes and shiny black hair. Usha's a tangle of curls, and Imtiaz's cut short at the nape to fit inside her swim cap. But in every other way,
us two, sisters, no.
Every time she thought up something, it sounded wrong.
How can it be so hard to write a few words? Swim. I need to swim. Just write anything to get Deliz off your back,
Imtiaz told herself, still hesitating over what she should say.
Not sorry for Usha that her grandma died. I'm sorry for me.
Sorry that Usha will be miserable. From what Deliz told her, Usha and her gran had been pretty much best friends. In a way, she felt more sorry for Usha. Maybe Deliz was right, and she would soon come out of her shell.
But even so, I'm not pretending to be someone I'm not. I didn't get the name Say It How It Is Imtiaz from nowhere, she thought, as she wrote, Dear Usha, I'm sorry about your gran dying. See you soon, Imtiaz.
Licking the envelope left a bitter taste in her mouth. Grabbing her swimming kit from the crate, she peered through her doorway, where she could still hear Deliz talking.
What am I supposed to do now, with everything packed away?
Imtiaz wondered, idling over to her crate and taking out her life book, containing the cutting about her first days in the world. Though she'd memorized every word, reading it always brought tears. Newspaper baby. Social worker finds newborn in London fields. Local resident and experienced social worker Deliz Lovelace was walking her new rescue dog in London fields on Thursday evening when her dog, named Tug, drew her attention to a bin on the far side of the park. After several attempts to recall Tug, Ms. Lovelace was forced to cross the park to pull her dog away from the debris.
I thought it was a bit of chicken and chips he was scavenging around for, Ms. Lovelace explained. But when I got close, I realized he was gently nudging open a newspaper, and to my horror, a newborn baby rolled out onto the grass. I was in shock, but I swaddled her in my coat and took her straight to the hospital. There is a police search for the mother. No note or identification has been found. The child is presently without a name. In all likelihood, this was a hidden pregnancy, Ms. Lovelace said. I assume the mother could be very young, frightened, and in need of medical assistance.
Laying the clipping aside, Imtiaz took out the rolled-up newspaper and out of habit sniffed it, despite the fact that the paper her baby self had been wrapped in had never smelt of anything but damp and a slight whiff of mould.
A familiar heat of anger rose in her.
As if I was a piece of rubbish.
The paper had grown soft and smooth to the touch, like a worn blanket, from so many handlings.
What's the point of keeping this?
She had the urge to rip it up into tiny pieces.
I never want to see this again. Why did Delise save me and look out for me for so long just to abandon me? If she's going to make a fresh start, why shouldn't I?
Imtiaz tore through to the office, where Delise was still on the phone. Ignoring her whispered questions, Imtiaz held her article and newspaper blanket over the shredder that turned everything to spaghetti.
Immy, stop! What are you doing?
Delise grabbed Imtiaz's shoulders, pulling her away from the shredder with such force that Imtiaz lost her balance and toppled onto the floor.
Sorry, Immy. Are you hurt? I didn't mean... What were you thinking? You can't destroy your past like that.
Delise soothed, kneeling next to her. Tears rolled unchecked down Imtiaz's cheeks. Taking the card out of her pocket, she flung it at Delise.
Here! It's a crap past, so why shouldn't I? What about my loss? Who's writing me a card to say sorry?
While Delise held Imtiaz in her arms, the pent-up feelings she had not known how to express opened like a dam rushing out of her.
You said that someone in the government shredded your parents' landing papers, and now nothing can be repaired, and it's too upsetting, so you've decided to make a new start? Well, if you can go off with Merv and pretend you're just setting out on some sort of adventure, then why can't I shred everything sad and start again too? Why should anyone else read my story? It's literally rubbish.
Imtiaz held the newspaper in her hands as the words shot out of her in wild sobs. She clenched her fists as if she was about to crumple it.
What's the point of remembering?
Slowly, softly, Delise unraveled the scrumpled paper blanket and placed it over Imtiaz's shoulder.
Because this contains one of the most precious little souls I've ever met.
Delise swaddled Imtiaz in the flimsy paper, as if it still contained the newborn baby she had found and named. Delise's chest heaved up and down, struggling to control her emotion too as Imtiaz's tears darkened the paper. She kissed Imtiaz on the forehead so tenderly that it felt as if she was being touched by a feather.
Immy, my little warrior miracle, you hold on to that fight in you. Please take me with you.
Delise's heavy sigh spoke for her.
Then take this so you won't be able to forget me,
Imtiaz said, thrusting her newspaper blanket at Delise.
Don't you get it? I'll never be Immy to anyone except you.
Blue Mirror. The blue of the pool and the sky admired each other in a still, clear mirror. As ever, when Imtiaz was near water, she felt her shoulders ease away from her ears and her spine lengthen as if her body knew better than she where it belonged. Not that she had any time for Delise's horoscopes, but she had to agree that Pisces the fish was definitely the right zodiac sign for her.
How can Usha live so close to this place and not like swimming?
She wondered.
Maybe I could get her into it. Hurry up, Delise!
Imtiaz called into the changing room, surveying the vast expanse of water stretching out in front of her. She pulled her goggles over her head and secured the taut elastic behind her ears.
Can't believe we're the only ones here,
she said, as Delise emerged in her flip-flops with a bright turquoise towel wrapped around her middle.
She does look quite old,
Imtiaz thought, as she watched Delise cautiously pad her way to the water's edge. Flicking off a flip-flop, she tentatively dipped her toe in and gasped.
Oh, I need heat.
Delise shivered overdramatically. "Well, you'll get it soon," Imtiaz was tempted to snap back.
"It's not that cold. You've just got to jump in,"
Imtiaz yelled as she made a star of her body and flopped on the water, splashing a mini waterfall over Delise's dimply legs and arms.
"Ugh, that's ice, not water."
Delise shivered as she wrung out the end of her towel.
"Thanks. Oh, what's the point of all those diving lessons I got you if you're just going to belly flop?"
Delise's infectious laughter echoed joy around the pool.
"I will so miss Delise's laugh," Imtiaz thought, as she watched her unravel the towel stowed under her arm, wrap it around her shoulders, and head towards the viewing platform.
Looking up, Imtiaz caught the expression on the lifeguard's face as she sat on her ladder, watching her one responsibility like a hawk, making her risk assessment.
"I'll show her."
Imtiaz smiled to herself as she hauled herself out again and prepared her best dive. Balancing her feet on the edge of the pool, knees bent and braced, concertinaing her power for a second like a flattened spring, body poised, sleek and arrow sharp, she made her leap. Arching down, propelling herself under, then rising, her arms grew into butterfly wings sweeping through the water. In slow, even strokes, Imtiaz pushed wave after wave of doubt away as she ploughed on, surfacing and dipping down, letting her new reality ripple over her.
"My new family, Usha. My new family, Tanvi. My new family, Lem. Usha. Sister, Usha, sister, Usha, Usha."
Breathing Usha's name to the end of her breath, she snatched a deep gulp before fully reaching the surface. Her lungs gagged as the chlorinated water gushed in where air should have been. She coughed and spluttered violently. The lifeguard was halfway down the steps when Imtiaz waved to reassure her that she was fine. Over on a bench, Delise's head lolled onto her chest while she dozed. Ignoring the lifeguard's suspicious stare, Imtiaz pushed off the side and floated on her back, feeling her knotted sinews untangle. Wanting rid of the screen between her and the water, she pulled off her goggles and threw them poolside, blinking several times at the stinging sensation as chlorine seeped in. Rubbing her eyes to clear the blur, her attention was caught by a woman wearing a white sari, walking barefoot to the water's edge, her long grey plait swaying heavily. As the woman approached, the pale green trim of her white cotton sari dragged through the water. She was now in touching distance of Imtiaz, who reached under the gentle waves to lift the cloth out. But as she did, it seemed to slip through her fingers, fold after fold unravelling into the choppy waves like fast-moving clouds. Imtiaz dived down to catch the ends, but it dissolved at her touch. When she surfaced, bleary-eyed, the woman had gone. Scanning all around the pool, she found only the now bored-looking lifeguard and Elise stirring from her sleep. Heart pounding against her sternum, Imtiaz flexed her feet and kicked hard off the side.
"Get a grip, Imtiaz Joseph." "The problem with swimming," she thought, "is it loosens up your imagination so much you feel like you're dreaming."
She let herself drift. Releasing her arms behind her head, Imtiaz lengthened her spine against the blue diamond tiles that line divided the bottom of the pool. She felt like an ancient creature of the deep, huge, powerful and peaceful, navigating her way along shimmering channels. The sleep-lulling whale song she had listened to every night when she was little sounded through her, so that she felt like a vast underwater being moving through its own sparkling habitat.
"And I think Usha's weird,"
Imtiaz smiled to herself, greedily gulping air as she surfaced to reality, to find Deliz standing above her.
I'm freezing, Deliz grumbled. I'll meet you in the cafe for a hot chocolate when you're done, and then we can get Usha's card posted.
Did you see that woman in the white sari?
Imtiaz asked, grabbing hold of Deliz's foot.
No, but then I had a little snooze,
Deliz admitted, heading for the changing rooms.
Don't be long.
Swim, just swim, Imtiaz told herself. After a while, she stopped counting the lengths, stopped worrying about someone else breaking the pattern that she was making in the water, the pattern that made her feel like she could do anything, be anyone, and really have a new family that would love her as if she was their own. Every so often, she would turn her head to the side and scan the pool for signs of the woman in the sari. Imtiaz and Deliz walked down the wide, tree-lined road towards Usha's house. It was all so different from the noisy double lines of traffic outside Acorn's children's home. Taking the envelope from her pocket, Imtiaz climbed the steps to the house that would soon be hers. The sharp, pronged metal railings to the left and right, and the imposing pillars, seemed suddenly jail-like. The impressive black door that had always been wide open for the people at the hearth shouted, "Do not enter."
To her left, in the side bay window, delicate paws peeled back white lace curtains and a cat's curious face stared at her with one brown and one green eye.
I didn't know they had a cat, Imtiaz smiled.
Nor did I.
Just pop that in the letterbox, Deliz urged.
We don't want to disturb anyone today.
I wish I'd written something better now,
Imtiaz winced as she heard the card drop into a metal cage and joined Deliz, who stood on the pavement, neck straining upwards, her hands open as if ready to catch something.
Just look at those roses, Deliz gasped as a flurry of white petals drifted down.
Imtiaz opened her palm and caught them.
Like confetti.
She laughed and threw them over Deliz.
When you and Merv get married, you'd better make me your bridesmaid. I'll be yours and Usha can be Merv's. But just so you know, I'm not wearing a dress. I've looked it up. You can get wed on a beach in St. Lucia.
We're way past retirement age, Immy. I think we're both a bit long in the tooth for that. Our plan is to just sail away into the sunset together.
You're sailing there? I thought you said you booked a flight.
Deliz chuckled.
Immy, you've got to learn not to take everything so literally.
Imtiaz sighed and linked her arm tightly through Deliz's, like she would never let her go. Uncharted Waters.
Right, time to get dressed, Ush. There's so much to do before the ceremony. I thought I'd go and collect some rose petals. You want to help?
Usha's mum tuttered as she caught sight of Spirit arching her back and stretching on Kalimar's bed. Yawning noisily, Usha smiled as the cat yawned too.
That stray, still making herself at home? You shouldn't let her on the beds,
Tanvi complained.
Too late for that.
Spirit seemed to have already claimed Kalimar's bed as her own. Maybe by the time Imtiaz took her old bed and she moved over to Kalimar's, the cat would trust her enough to let her near.
Spirit,
Usha called, and the cat paused and turned slowly, heads tilted, eyes questioning.
I think the name suits you,
Usha whispered to the delicate white cat, now padding across the deck, steadily surveying her from the safe distance of the anchor.
Usha had named her Spirit because the cat had half scared her to death when, on the day of her Kalimar's funeral, her trembling hands had unfolded the bedcovers and discovered nothing more ghostly than a hissing cat that had peered at her with its one green eye, one brown eye, looking just as surprised as she was. Now it felt strangely comforting not to be alone, even if Spirit was only a stray that had come to keep her company for a while. Ignoring her mum's complaints, Usha crept across the uneven floorboards, past the giant anchor that Spirit had claimed as her lookout post. Usha loved to follow the cat's path down the sunken steps into the heart of the room, to her own anchor den with its comfy cushions. There, Spirit either curled up or braced herself to leap onto the anchor's feet, deftly climbing to the zenith point on the curve of its rusted spine that floated halfway between floor and ceiling. From there, Spirit's eyes now followed her as she drew closer to Kalimar's boat bed, which she'd insisted she didn't mind moving into so that Imtiaz could take hers. But now the time had come to swap. She wondered how she would ever sleep in it. There had never been sides to their room when Kalimar had been alive. It had always been just one big open space. All in all, Usha thought that the new layout worked quite well. Pushing both beds away from the walls further out towards the anchor and using the triangular sails as screens had achieved what she'd wanted and created privacy for both of them. When closed, their bed sails made one room into two. The anchor was their room divider and formed the corridor to the globe window leading out onto the roof terrace.
Usha pushed her bedside sail screen closed. From behind, it did really feel like this was her side of the room.
"I wonder if we'll ever open these to talk," Usha pondered, pushing the bamboo pole that held the triangular sail taut.
It swung open easily, sending Spirit leaping off the anchor and scarpering across the floorboards, out through the half-opened giant eyelid of the ship's porthole. The window-come-glass door that her pops Michael had found in the reclamation of an ocean liner's wreckage. The globe window, he'd called it, and the name had stuck. Our very own porthole onto the world. Spirit had knocked it on her way out, causing it to tilt fully open. Now a dazzling stream of light snaked across the bleached floorboards, illuminating what Pops Michael's sailing obsession had turned into, the top deck of their family ship.
"That cat nearly sent me flying," Tanvi called from the terrace.
Usha walked over to the anchor and sat on the top step that led down to her cushion-scattered den.
"Breezy out here. Give me a hand, Ush. Plenty of petals to collect," Tanvi called. "I'm getting dressed, Mum," Usha called back, but didn't move.
Her hair lifted off the nape of her neck, flowing behind her. Glancing over to Imtiaz's boat bed, she felt a pang of resentment. Even though the new room plan had been her idea, the top deck now looked suddenly shrunken and cluttered. Impossible to believe that this harbour of peace and quiet that had always belonged to her and her Kalimar would have to be shared with a stranger with eyes as piercing and unflinching as Spirit's. Usha closed her own eyes against the mounting tension at her temples that seemed to flare up whenever she thought of Imtiaz moving in.
"This sister idea was such a mistake. Can I say I've changed my mind?" Usha muttered. "You have to stop talking to Kalimar," she reminded herself.
Realizing she had broken her own new rule, she flattened her hand over her mouth. But no matter how many times she told herself not to, she seemed incapable of breaking the habit.
"What if I say I can't do it? That it's too soon after you've died to even think about Imtiaz moving in?"
Usha imagined her Kalimar reaching for her hand, reassuring her.
"You agree? You think I should tell Mum and Dad then?"
Usha took a deep breath. It was all too much. Pressing her spine against the anchor's metal curve, her mind drifted to the silty seabeds of her Kalimar's stories, which she in turn said had once been told to her by Pops Michael.
"Tiny iridescent fish darted through inky depths among flowers of bright coral." Kalima and Pops Michael's voices fused in her ear. Tears rolled down her cheeks.
Why did you have to die now, Kalima?
Scanning the walls, Usha took in afresh what she had hardly noticed just weeks before. The vintage black and white pictures of her Kalima's fashion shoots. The thick, misted glass of the ancient navigation clock. The shiny dark wood of the rafters that her Pops Michael had lovingly collected from old ships. Even their beds were carved in the shape of boats, with sails attached now too.
To think that Pops Michael made all this for you, Kalima.
Usha smiled through her tears as she raised her hand into a dust stream of light, picturing the spirit of her Kalima floating towards a waiting Pops Michael.
How long does it take to pass from the land of the living, Kalima? Where are you now?
That cat snuck back in, asked Tanvi, appearing at the globe window carrying a basket of rose petals. Usha shook her head.
I thought you'd be dressed by now, Tanvi sighed, and eased herself down beside Usha on the anchor steps.
Usha winced into the sunlight.
My head hurts,
Tanvi sighed.
We'll all feel more settled after today, Ush.
This is my last chance, Usha thought.
Mum, you know how you were telling me I should say what's on my mind?
Tanvi nodded, drawing closer.
I should have said before, but now Imtiaz is actually coming. I don't think it's a good idea.
Usha hesitated, attempting to soften the blow.
I mean, it doesn't seem like a good time for her to move in.
Tanvi smiled gently, wrapping an arm around Usha's shoulders. Let's get through today, and then we'll talk about everything. Adopting Imtiaz is a big deal for all of us. It's natural to have some last-minute nerves. Tanvi peered over to Kalima's bed, opening her hand to reveal a pressed rose petal. She raised it to her own nose and offered it to Usha. Remind you of anything?
The perfume I used to make for Kalima.
Tanvi smiled and rubbed the petal over Usha's wrists. The sweet memory scent brought tears. Resting her head against her mum's shoulder, Usha allowed Tanvi to smooth over her tangle of curls as she used to when Usha was little. The light from the globe window shifted, rippling a river of light across the floorboards.
Nothing's in straight lines anymore, Mum.
Usha sobbed, letting the grief rip through her, feeling her mum's heart beating against hers, torn breath by breath, until finally her chest began to ease. You know what, Usha? I think you've been up here on your own with your Kalima for too long, and it's our fault for always being so busy in the hearth. I've got an idea that Imtiaz coming might help to take you out of yourself, make it easier to get on with people your own age. So when you start secondary school after the summer, Usha's shoulders tensed as she shrugged her mum off.
I don't want to think about school now.
Tanvi tapped Usha's knee and picked up the rose petal basket. You're right. Come on. Let's give Kalima the final send-off she ordered. You can't do that in your PJs. Ma would not approve of that. Come on, Mush. Get your glad rags on. Tanvi and Usha chorused together, bringing smiles. Tanvi nodded towards Kalima's enormous floor-to-ceiling dark wood wardrobe, casting a shadow over the bed that was now to be Usha's.
But, Mum, if Imtiaz is coming, she can't keep wandering over to my side. And anyway, I'm not having her going through Kalima's things.
Okay, we'll work it all out. Tanvi kissed Usha's wild hair. And give that mop a brush, she said, heading downstairs, as if something had been agreed.
I wish you'd told me what you wanted me to wear, Kalima.
Usha pulled back the sail screen and climbed over her bed, her bare feet padding across the soft rug to the wall that Kalima's bed had once rested against, the space now taken up by Kalima's pride and joy of a wardrobe with its fruit-engraved panelling. Laying her hands flat against the heavy oak doors, Usha took a deep breath and pulled both sides open together, scanning from her own clothes on one side to Kalima's collections on the other.
There is no way Imtiaz is putting her things in here. Don't worry, Kalima. I won't let anyone replace you, she whispered.
Kneeling, Usha scanned the rows of satin shoes in every colour, and, hanging above them, she admired row after row of Kalima's sample fashion collection.
Start with the shoes. Always start with the shoes, Mish.
Usha smiled at the memory of Kalima speaking her nickname as she reached into the bottom of the wardrobe. Pulling out a single shoe, she dropped it again at the sound of mewling. Spirit emerged, dislodging the matching one.
Okay, here's the pair. Clever cat.
Usha placed the slipper-like shoes on her feet, slightly loose at the back. They fitted a bit like her summer espadrilles. From the drawers in her side of the wardrobe, she grabbed her underwear, a white t-shirt, and a pair of jeans, while Spirit climbed further in, meandering along the rows of kimonos and silken coats.
Come on then, Kalima. It's your day. You choose.
Closing her eyes, Usha let her hand drift through the soft silk and cotton materials, the lengths of sari cloth, the bright coloured print samples, jackets and dresses. As Spirit's tail brushed her hand, she opened her eyes.
Trust me a bit more now, Usha asked.
And in answer, Spirit pawed at the hem of a gaudy orange kimono coat. Usha stared at Spirit's mismatching eyes, and the cat returned her stare unflinchingly.
If you were going to come back as anything, Kalima, you would definitely be a cat, with your style and serious attitude.
Usha sighed at the wildness of her own thoughts.
It's your fault I've got all this reincarnation stuff in my head.
Spirit pawed at her, as if to say, get on with it.
Okay.
Usha threw on the coat and checked herself out in the long wardrobe mirror.
Well, you love clashing colours, so...
Usha reached up to her bare neck. Bending down, she eased out the lacquered chest where she had tucked Kalima's precious things. Removing the lid and sliding her hand in, she attempted to retrieve the necklace without having to unpack the whole box again. It must have slipped to the bottom. Everything would have to come out. Carefully, Usha laid the conch shell, satchel, and a box of slides on the floor.
Feels weird to go through your things without you, Kalima.
The lacquered box was empty now, but there was no necklace.
I definitely put it in here.
Usha frowned, confused. Unless her mum had taken it. Usha picked up the satchel that had belonged to Pops Michael and shook it. Something rattled inside. Peering into it, Usha sighed with relief as she caught sight of the jade skull necklace that her Kalima had gifted her the day before she died. Placing it over her head, she checked herself in the inset mirror of the wardrobe door, inspecting the soft smokiness of the jade beads.
It's just a necklace.
She reassured herself, as, forehead furrowed, she tried not to stare at the hollow cheeks, bumpy skulls and deep eye cavities that had always seemed a bit grim, but now, with Kalima gone, felt full-on gruesome. The necklace lay like a dragging weight against her chest.
How did you wear this every day, Kalima? I'll put it on today because I know how much you love it. After that, it's going back in the box.
Usha glanced down to where Spirit was busy sniffing around the satchel.
Let's see.
Picking it up, she unbuckled the worn leather straps and opened it fully. Empty. But, flattening her palm, she felt around inside a document compartment and was amazed to find a thin, brown book. She'd always assumed the satchel was empty. Carefully, she pulled it out.
You didn't show me this, Kalima.
Spirit rubbed her head over the book's cover as Usha attempted to decipher what was written there in unevenly formed childlike letters. Her spine fizzed with anticipation to discover something of her Kalima's that she'd never seen. Handling it as if it might fall apart on touch, Usha read, Essie Morp Book by Kali Gopal, aged 11. How strange and comforting it felt to be holding something that had belonged to her Kalima at her own age.
Your handwriting was terrible, Kalima. Is that why you didn't want me to see this? What's Essie Morp?
But now Usha's attention was caught by a yellowing label in old-fashioned typewriter print stuck below her Kalima's writing with the words, In consultation with Dr. N.K. Mystery.
What is this, Kalima?
Behind Usha, Spirit sniffed the air and circled restlessly around the upside-down conch shell, setting it rocking next to her on the floor. Usha carefully leant the book on her knees and turned the pages. Every bit of space was covered by her Kalima's drawings. Reading it felt like collapsing time between them. It also felt wrong, like she should be asking for permission to look. Usha bit her lip.
Kalima is dead. You've got to stop talking to her and accept it.
In any case, now she'd taken this peek into her Kalima's childhood, she couldn't stop herself from reading on. Young Kalima had chalked and charcoaled many pictures. Usha flicked back and forth through its oddly repetitive imagery of a woman in a floaty dress with a long plait trailing down her back. In her hands, she carried something that looked like a shell, and at other times, a round pink smudge like a bowl, or perhaps a ball of wool.
Who's this Dr. Mystery? Why were you seeing a doctor? Is this like Mum's art therapy class with people at the hearth?
Usha smiled as her eyes scanned the images. They seemed so childish. No way could anyone be able to predict from looking at these rough sketches that Kalima would one day be destined for art school. Usha couldn't quite work out what was strange about the sketches, except that they looked like they'd been done in a frenzy, as if she was desperate to show someone her dreams. Or nightmares. As Usha touched the pages, the chalky drawings smudged a little, releasing dust, but something else, too, that came creeping over her like a smell. An unsettling, pent-up energy rose from the pages. Peering closer at the repeated image of the woman, Usha realized that the ankle-length gown with fishtail folds was not a dress at all, but a sari. Spirit's sharp meow pierced her concentration. Usha dropped the book, her heart pounding hard, feeling like an intruder on her Kalima's childhood, but unable to pull herself away as she began to notice that here and there, a few words and names were repeated.
Michael. Is this Pops Michael? You knew him then, didn't you?
Usha leafed through the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.